Hi folks, I'm going to take a look at an old piece of technology that was produced in the mid-80s by a company called Dallas Semiconductors. Back in the early days of personal computing, it was fairly common for a computer not to have a real-time clock. And by that I mean a hardware clock rather as a clock running in MS-DOS. Now, without an RTC, you could set the date and time, but after a power off, it would reset to some arbitrary date, perhaps the 1st of January 1980. An RTC allowed the clock to keep ticking with its own battery and transferred into DOS on boot up. The advantage of the Dallas product was that it was hardware independent and didn't take up a dedicated ISA slot or peripheral port. It had the ability to be either inserted between a ROM chip and the main board, or take the space of a RAM chip. It would then look out for specific commands flying about on the bus that only it would know what to do with, and that would then respond, giving it the nickname of a phantom clock. Now, the problem that we have with the Dallas solution is that they haven't made these for many years, and they were designed with an inbuilt battery that had a shelf life of about 10 years. Now 30 years later they're well and truly shot. The problem being that the battery is potted in epoxy in the base here, and on this version there are two of them. You can just about see two indentations here and here, which are the 3-volt button cells, which are then connected internally to the various pins of the Dallas chip there. Now, if we connect a new battery to this, there's a good chance that the old batteries are going to either drain or short out the new ones. So we need some way of disconnecting those internal batteries without making too much of a mess. Now, as I said, there's two versions of this. There's the RAM or the ROM version, and as this is the RM Nimbus channel, I'm going to go with the ROM version, which is this one here. Make sure you pay attention to the letter that's on the version that you've got. You need the E version for this particular application. It's a 28-pin socket. This one takes the place of the Nimbus ROM. So you take the ROM chip out, place this one on, and the ROM chip sits back on top of this. So we need some way of disconnecting these batteries. And as I say, you can just about see them here. Now, I've taken one of these completely apart in the past, so I know where the bridges are for the connections. This one will be around here, and this one around here. So counting the pins down from the top, this one being pin 1, the first battery is going to be somewhere between pins 8 and 9. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8 and 9. Somewhere around here. And pin 13 and 14, so somewhere around here. So we can do that with a Dremel, sort of keyhole surgery, if you will, and just sever those connections. And then we need to make new battery connections directly onto the chip. There's not a great deal of space to get your soldering iron into these gaps here, but what you can do is just cut away a sliver of the plastic with a Stanley knife or something, just to give yourself a bit more room. Now, if we look at the diagram for the chip, we can see that the two batteries are going to pins 4 and 14. As I say, not all the versions have two batteries, so you need to bear that in mind. Now, it does say that if you've only got the one battery, you should tie pin 14 to ground, but I found no significant problem with just ignoring that. In fact, on the chips that I usually put together, I usually attach the external battery directly to pin 14 and ignore pin 4, or connect them both to 4 and 14. Either way, it doesn't seem to make a great deal of difference. Now, what I like to do on the versions that I put together is I like to put an external battery that's removable. So something like this, just a coin cell CR2032 button cell battery, just with a little connector on the end of it, just for easy removal for when you're putting these into storage. The last thing you want is the batteries leaking everywhere, so it's just nice to be able to disconnect the unit altogether. Now, one that I prepared earlier in the grand old tradition, this is the Aero Nimbus ROM chip here, inserted into the Phantom clock chip, and you can just see underneath where I've severed the connections. If I bring this up a little bit closer, you can perhaps see. You can just see a slight metallic point here, which is the bridge of the battery holder being severed. So as we can see, that's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. So just around there is our connection, and there for the other one. I thought we'd just take a quick look at measuring the battery voltages just to confirm that there is a problem. If you recall, the battery connections go to pins 4 and 14. Pin 8 is ground. So if we go into ground here on pin 8 and pin 4, you can see there's not much coming through there. And on pin 14, a little bit more, but not even 1 volt there, 0.6 of a volt. Just double check number 4 again. Yeah, battery 1 is even worse. So what we'll do, we'll get the Dremel out and I'll show you how to sever the connections there. Just I'd pause there for a moment just so that you can see that halfway through here we've just got a little bit of view on the connection here. See if I can just get that to show up on camera. You can just see the metallic battery strap here. And the idea is just to sever that. There's not really much in this space here. It's just all epoxy. The batteries are located around here and here. So you're not going to cut through anything other than epoxy resin, really, unless you get really deep, in which case you'll hit the circuit board here. So I'll keep going with the Dremel until I've severed that connection there. Difficult to see, but the connection, the bridge has now been severed. So we just need to do the same with the other one up here. So again, I'm just trying to get it to show up on camera so that you can see the small bridge. There we go, perfect. As you can see, it's not very far down within the epoxy. It's quite a shallow hole. You can see actually better now the severed connection here. Between that point there and that point there, so it's been severed. So we need to do the same on this one, just essentially cut through. This is only a very thin bridge, so it doesn't take much to cut through it. The two connections severed. I've just sprayed the base of this with a little bit of electrical contact cleaner to get rid of the dust. I think that helps show you that the connections, where they are and where they've been severed. You can just make out here the connection between here and here has been severed, and the connection between here and the rest of it here has been severed. Okay, so we've now severed the battery connections. We're looking to solder some new connections on. Now you've got a couple of ways of doing this. You can just simply solder some wires to either pin 4 or 14 and 8 for the ground, and just run the wires out to the side. There's a bit of a gap here that they can fit out from, and wire that into a battery connector, and jobs are good. Or you can put a quick connect on, which will allow you to disconnect the battery later on. So the way I like to do this is get some header pins, take one of them out so that it matches the normal pin layout of a BIOS backup battery connector. So that it fits like that. So we've got a quick disconnect. We need some way of mounting that onto the connector here. So the best way I've found to do that is to mount it in here, which involves just cutting away a bit of the plastic so that it can fit onto it. So again, we can just do that with the Dremel. Hopefully you'll have a slightly safer scalpel than I'm using here, but it's all I have to hand. We're nearly there. We'll just take a little bit more off with the Dremel. that's what we're looking to achieve, just so that the it sits flush in the unit. And then we can just pop a bit of super glue in there. Now that we've cleared a space at the end here, we need to make a connection to pin 4 and or pin 14 and pin 8. So again, I think we'll just get the Dremel on the go and just create a bit of space there for the soldering iron. It's not very easy to get into there with a Dremel, so again I think we'll pull out the Stanley knife and just give it another go. A little bit more room in there. I think I'll just wash it out with a little bit of contact cleaner. Okay, so a little bit more space in there to join our wires onto. Unfortunately, I have checked and none of these extra pads here, which would be much more accessible, are linked to the battery connections. So unfortunately, the only way of doing this is to do it the way that we're currently attempting now. So we'll let that dry off a little bit and then we'll start soldering some connections onto those wires to the connector here at the end. So I'll join a few wires onto these connections. This one at this end here is the ground connector. And we'll go with the red wire for the positive. trim that wire slightly, it's a little bit long. Okay, so that's our connection. What we're looking to do is mount this in the end here. Just like that. And then we'll be looking to join this onto pin 4, and this will wrap round onto pin 8. So I'll just pause the video while I straighten that up and super glue it into place. Okay, so that's the end connector glued into place. We've got a couple of flying leads on there, and we're just going to tin the legs of the Dallas chip. Not the neatest job in the world, but considering the space limitations, I'm not doing too badly. I might just put a little bit more on that pin 8 ground chip. So there we go. I'll just give that a bit of a clean up. And those are your connections. It's flush with the top there. Maybe just get rid of that lump there. So there you have it. Just give that a bit of a clean. Okay, that's it been cleaned up. The end connector glued into place. So all that's left is to mount that onto your motherboard. Put the ROM chip back on top. You'll need custom software to get this to function. Something I didn't cover at the start of this video is that this isn't a direct system replacement for a real-time clock, in that the system doesn't know it's there. What it essentially is a separate device that needs to be told what the time is, and the computer needs to be told what the time is also from this device. So the idea behind the software is that you would set the time within MS-DOS, and then you run a command which communicates with this and tells it to set the time to be the same as MS-DOS. So at that point, the internal clock within here is ticking at its own speed, separate to the MS-DOS clock, but of course they should both be in sync at that point. And when the computer is running, this chip is being powered from the computer, and when you shut down the computer, it automatically switches to its backup supply, which you'll have plugged in here. So at that point, the time will continue to be clocked up inside here. When the computer reboots, it won't automatically know what the time is. So you need to interrogate this chip again with the software to tell it to set the MS-DOS time to be the time that it thinks it is. Very straightforward process. You just execute it within your AutoExec sequence, and that will set the MS-DOS time. I'll put links to some software down below. There is an issue with the Y2K compliance. This actually has the Y2K bug. The government searched high and low and paid millions of pounds to detect the Y2K bug. I don't think they found very much of it, but it's alive and well within this chip. It only stores the date as two digits, which is fine. So I suppose you could argue that the Y2K bug isn't within here. It's somewhat limited by the software that interrogates it, and it automatically put 19 in front of it for up to 1999. However, because it only stores the last two digits of the year, the software has to be rewritten to work with a 20. Now, I've rewritten the software for the RM Nimbus, which you're happy to use. However, it is branded with the RM Nimbus information, but it should still function on any other PC and will work with a 20 date. So there you go, the Dallas Phantom Clock, produced over 30 years ago. I don't think they thought that it would still be in operation today, especially with those inbuilt batteries. But with a little bit of knowledge, knowing how to separate those batteries, you can get these things up and running again. And with the removable battery connector there, there's no reason this shouldn't continue for many, many years. So there you go. Thank you for watching.